So we're ready to look at bases and do all the similar things that we did with acids, working with strong bases and weak bases. So just like with acids, a strong base is one that completely ionizes in water, 100%. And the metal hydroxides that are soluble in water meet this criteria. All metal hydroxides, they're ionic compounds, and ionic compounds ionize 100%. They dissociate 100%. But since they're acids and bases, we don't use the word dissociate, we use the word ionize. Now, we say that all metal hydroxides fit the description. Only the soluble ones are worth talking about, because you can't make an acid solution in water if it's not soluble in water. And these four are the most common four of your list. Now, I want you to make sure at the recording of this video, how many we make you be responsible for kind of changes. These are very soluble. There's some kind of borderline ones like calcium hydroxide that they might throw in there. And we always present to you as a separate sheet the exact list to memorize. But these are the four most soluble ones. But truly, if you have any problem and it's a metal hydroxide, okay, a metal with OH is attached, it is a strong base. Assume it is, because all metal hydroxides are. But you get used to looking at these, because these are the most soluble of the bunch. Now, what do they do when they dissolve in water the way we would write it? A metal hydroxide, when you dissolve it into water 100%, it's a one-way arrow, breaks apart into these ions, okay? Aqueous. You take the solid, you place it in water, and you have this happen 100% of the way. Okay, so what we need to be able to do is, well, let's talk about weak bases. Weak bases, therefore, don't have the one-way arrow, have a reversible arrow. We see an example of ammonia, NH3, right there, being written for a weak base. Your weak bases will all be a nitrogen compound where the nitrogen has three bonds to it, okay? So this is ammonia, we see the three bonds. Nitrogen with three bonds. Why is that the case? Well, there is a lone pair on there that's ready to accept a proton. It is a proton acceptor that's a base. These might not be hydrogens, but maybe carbon groups like a methyl, a CH3 group. And maybe one of them is a hydrogen, okay? How would that be written? We might see it written as NHCH32. It's a nitrogen. Let me get out of the way. Nitrogen with three things connected to it, all right? It might be something like this. A nitrogen, and maybe it's in a ring, okay? And has some carbons, some stuff around here, and I won't draw the rest of it in. But when we see it, there is a nitrogen with three bonds. Your neutral molecules that have a nitrogen in them tend to be bases. All of your weak bases fit this, okay, that you will run into. All right, so here is kind of an image of those two things. The one on the left is a strong base, and we see that every KOH that goes into the solution breaks apart, and all the K's are separated from all the OH's. But on the right-hand side, it looks like they're dumping four of those ammonias in there. Not all of those ammonias pick up a proton. Only some of them do. So one is fitting the description that it is ionizing, breaking apart 100%. The other one is still a base, and that is a proton acceptor, but it is not breaking apart 100%. Most of them are staying grouped together. Okay. When it's weak, you would write the reaction that you're working with. It's a protonic swap, and now the water is donating to the base, so you don't end up with H3O plus, you end up with OH minus in there, so it meets the description of being a base. And for that reaction, let's write the equilibrium constant expression. Well, it would be K is equal to, and we'll talk about the subscript here in just a minute, products, ammonia, and there is an error in that slide I just now recognized. There's not supposed to be an L after NH3. So I'm going to go over here to the slide and fix it for you. This is actually supposed to be dissolved in the water, so it's supposed to be an AQ, okay? So fix that. It should be included in my expression. NH, I'm having trouble here, NH4 plus, those are my two products, divided by the reactant, but I don't include the water because the water is a liquid. So now we have this equilibrium constant expression, okay? This would be called KB. It's the base ionization constant, okay? So it's a base ionization reaction. The base is ionizing. We've written the expression for it, and the value is KB. And like KA, there's all kinds of tables that are provided with that. When you're doing your online homework, make sure you use the table that they give you, because there may be mild variations in the numbers that you look up, and you always want to work the problems from the ones that they give you. All right, so what is the pH? We're going to work our first problem here. What is the pH of a 0.1 molar solution of sodium hydroxide? All right, so you're working a bunch of problems, and they're all going to get jumbled together, and you've got to train yourself. As soon as you're asked to calculate a pH, you have to ask yourself some questions. The first question you're going to ask yourself is, what is NaOH? So pick the right answer. Well, it is a strong base. I know it's not an acid, so I eliminate those, and then I have in my mind what makes a strong base a metal hydroxide, so I know it's a strong base. As a strong base, we can work the problem, and we'll work it together. You've got that space in your notes there. Now, what does the strong base do? Okay, it 100% breaks apart into Na plus plus OH minus. Now, I showed you, and I'm going to do it again, an ICF table when it was one way. Instead of an ICE, it's an ICF. We put in the initial concentration, 0.10. There isn't any of that, although there is a little hydroxide. Remember, it's in water, so there's 1 times 10 to the minus 7, that tiny amount there. Now, it's not going to be X's. This goes 100%. All of it gets used up. The change line is still this reaction taking place. Okay, but it takes a place completely. Every time one of these reacts, you make one of those, you make one of those. So you've consumed, and that's what always happens when it's strong. You've consumed all of that base. What do we have left? These guys. Now, you would not necessarily have to do this table. If you realize that you dump it in, and this reaction goes to completion, and whatever you put in here is what you have over here, great. Now, pH is what we're trying to determine. But pH is the negative log of the H3O plus concentration, right? I don't have the H3O plus concentration. I have the OH minus concentration. You've got a couple different routes you can take here. But what I tend to do, and you'll see me do it this way over and over again in our problems, is I'll take this and I'll get the POH from it, which is the negative log of that number. The POH is 1.0. And then I'll use the fact that if you added those two numbers together, pH and POH, that is, you would get 14. So I'm going to take my 14, and I will subtract my POH of 1, and I will get 13. And then I ask myself, please get yourself doing this, because it's so easy to do this and think, take the negative log of what you have here and think you have your answer. If you took the negative log and you said, I have a pH of 1, you'll say, wait a minute, this is a strong base. I can't have a pH of 1. Make that connection. You have to do this last step. Now I have a pH of 13. Now that one makes sense, okay? So we can do that value. All right, in our next one, we're going to calculate the pH of barium hydroxide. Now I can do real minor variations to this, and I'm going to do so. Instead of the N, I'm going to put a B, all right? Barium hydroxide. Instead of an N, I'm going to put a B, barium, and it has a 2 plus charge. And what should sit right there? A 2. Every time one of these dissolves, you're going to get 1 barium and 2 hydroxides. Okay? So let's erase my table. And let us get our numbers now. Okay? We'll have a different value right there. So let's do our change line. Every time one of these reacts, one of those is formed. So that didn't change. But every time one of these reacts, how many of those do you get? You get twice as many. All right? So I have a number of 0.2 there. And that is often forgotten by students. Okay? So now I have a different hydroxide concentration. I can take this number and I can get the pOH. The pOH is a negative log of 0.20. I've got twice as much hydroxide in there that I had before. Now that doesn't make the pH twice as big, okay? pH scale is a logarithmic scale. It takes 10 changes to change the pH by one, I mean 10 units to change it by one. But when I take the negative log of this number, I end up with 0.70. It's a little lower, okay? And so 14 minus 0.70 is 13.3. Okay? So it raised the pH a little bit. It didn't double the pH. It raised it a little bit. Now, it's worth saying, when we were dealing with strong acids, we said we can always assume the H3O plus was the concentration of the initial acid. It worked every time. We can't do that with bases. With these metal hydroxides, you have got to play out that coefficient in your hydroxide concentration. So it is strong, but the hydroxide concentration is not the same as the initial concentration of this base. The initial concentration is 0.10. The hydroxide concentration is 0.20. So that is working strong base problems. Let's see what's next. The next thing that we're going to work on, I'll erase this board here in just a second, is to work with a weak base.